I Know was a song that I wrote for my boyfriend, or a guy that I was starting to see. We were both in this place in our lives where everything was changing, and it, again, this thing, this stuff happens, coming from one word, because this guy was going through a lot of changes in his life, and he had just met me, and he referred to me one day as his crowbar, because it was getting him out of it was like, you know, changing his life in a certain way, where he had been in this one place, but the crowbar and the door was opening, and then he was going into another place. And as soon as he said, you know, you're like my crowbar, I, you know, my mind went so far, and then I wrote a song. So yeah. With Paper Bag, I was in my father's car. We were driving to the grocery store. And this is an idea of like how long it takes me to even deal with writing a song, is that this was during the recording of the first album, and I was miserable. And it was like a Saturday, and my dad and I were driving to the grocery store, and I was just, you know, sitting sulking, and I looked up into the sky, and I saw this in this white dove, and I thought, you know, I have like, I used to have a terrible problem with, everything was a symbol to me. I have obsessive compulsive disorder, and it was way in full swing then. So like everything that I saw meant, you know, life or death. So I look up into the sky, and I'm all sulking, and I see this white dove, and I thought, oh, everything's okay. I mean, I swung way up into this high, and I was like, oh, that's great, everything, oh, white dove. And it really started falling, and it was just a plastic bag. It was a plastic bag. And if so, of course, then I just dropped again. But that always stuck in my head, and then later on, you know, that was kind of like, oh, there it is, the rule of my life, you know, that it always looks like it's going to be something great, but then it's just a damn plastic bag. But, you know, and I made a paper bag because paper bag sounds better. And I just thought of that, and that image always stayed in my head, and it didn't make any sense in my life until years later. And then, you know, I grabbed it from the back of my head and made a song out of it. But lots of times that kind of stuff happens where I, you know, I'll notice something and then I'll ignore it, and then it'll come back at some point. After I got off the road for When the Pollen, as I did when I finished the first album on Being on the Road, I really kind of thought, okay, I'm done. It's going to be a while until I do anything. If I do anything, I never know if I'm going to write another song. So I was really happy. I just moved into a house that I loved, and I was, you know, just kind of relaxing all the time. And I was getting a lot of some people in my life, you know, saying, you've got to get back up and you've got to write. You're going to, you know, I know you, and you're going to be lazy and you're not going to be out there for years. And I was spending all of my time just sitting outside, really not reading, not listening to music, not really doing anything, just sitting outside, not thinking, just sitting outside. And I was getting so much flack for that from some people that were very close to me, and that I wrote the song Waltz, which is the last song on this album. And then, you know, to make myself feel better, pep talk for myself again, about how it was okay to be doing nothing, and that's exactly what I should be doing. After I wrote that song, that was, you know, I was like, okay, fine, I wrote a song about that. Now I'm back to doing nothing. And I really didn't write anything else for, you know, another year and a half or so. I started having lunch every week on Tuesdays with John Bryan. And we talk about, we weren't really talking about music that much. We're just, you know, friends having lunch. But every once in a while he'd say, are you writing? And I'd very quickly say no, and then we'd move on. And after a while, he just really wanted to, he was like, listen, I need this. We need to start working. And so we kind of, we decided to start doing it, since Sony wasn't bugging me in any way to make another album, which I really loved that they weren't like saying, when's the next one going to come out or anything. We were like, oh, we've got us like we're a step ahead, you know, we can start doing something and then they'll be thrilled when we have it. So we just kind of did a little bit of whatever songs I had, we did, because I like kind of lied to John when I said I wasn't writing because I didn't want to be pressured to do anything. And I fixed up some scraps of songs, and, you know, over the period of like a year and a half or 2 years, over, you know, staying at the Paramore, which is a big mansion in Silver Lake, and doing some recording at Ocean Studios and Cello Studios, we got a lot of the original version of the album done. But I really wasn't prepared to make the album. I really didn't know. I rushed writing the songs. I didn't rush writing the songs, but we rushed right from me having written the songs into recording them. And so I didn't know what I wanted them to sound like. Most of the time when I have a song, I live with it for a long time, and I play it a lot, you know, and I have an idea of what I want it to turn out like. And when we were recording When the Pond, John and I were, it was a perfect way to work, because I know the song when I go in, and I go, this is the song, this is the general idea of how it should feel. And then I record my parts, and then I leave because I don't like being in the studio. And then John stays there and he does 14,000 different things, which he likes to do because he likes being in the studio. And then when he's done all that stuff, I come back in and I listen to stuff, and I know what I do like and I know what I don't like. That worked totally perfectly on When the Pond. This time, I had no idea what I liked or didn't like. I just didn't have ears or a brain for my own songs, and it was scary to me, and I'm sure it was frustrating for him. But it kind of left me in this position where I knew that it, I mean, the stuff that we did was beautiful, but it wasn't what I had had in mind. And I didn't even know what I had in mind because I hadn't had time to figure that out. But I did know that it didn't have the right exact heartbeat that it should have. Although, and I have to stress this, that I do love the other versions of the songs. It's just that you can't be satisfied with something just because it's great. It has to be what you intend to do. And so, for lack of intentions and lack of the ability to make any decisions, I just thought, okay, well, I think I have to like kind of start again and try them in a different way. And I got it all set up, and Sony never shelved the album. We never finished that first one. It was never handed in as a finished product. And I don't think that they were happy with it. I don't think that they thought that there was a hit. I know that they don't think there was a hit because they asked me to write more songs, and you don't ask somebody to write more songs unless, you know, write more songs not like the ones that you've written was basically what it is, you know. But they never had an opportunity to say that it was shelved because I wasn't done yet. I was like, well, I want to try them again, try the songs again. And so they gave me a list of all these people to maybe produce, and I didn't, they gave me CDs and stuff. I didn't listen to any of it, and I didn't think about any of it. Mike Elizondo put his name out to be, he said that he wanted to do it. And I had met him twice before. I can't remember where we were the first time, but the second I can remember sitting on a bench and meeting him, he's one of those people that like you remember meeting because he's just so incredibly warm. I had met him on the When the Pond as he played upright bass. He was really into doing it, and he took the songs, and he went home and he made beats, and he kind of just put these little basic tracks together of the songs. And he came in and we had a meeting, and he played what he had, and it was like, whoa, okay, I'm awake now. Okay, I can build meat onto this skeleton. I know what I want now. It was like a fresh start, and I just felt more ready to do it. So we put a budget together. We were all ready to